title of this talk is Trust and the Spiritual Path. And I mentioned this to a woman who was on the way here, a delegate at this conference, and she said, oh, trust in the spiritual path, I trust spirit. I'm not going to your talk. And that's not what I'm going to be talking about. Okay, that's fine, that's one interpretation of it, because if you're not trusting that which is moving your life at this point, you probably wouldn't be here. So, so trust in the spiritual path. What I will be talking about is how your brain works, is how conditioning creates a filter that no matter what spiritual concept you use to drop a conditioning, a layer of conditioning, there is no way around going in there and digging it out by the root. And we'll be explaining the difference between things you have to dig out and things you can actually let go, and how this works in your brain. Let's look at trust itself first. Every now and then I'm going to refer to my slides simply because you never know where I could go otherwise. If we look at trust itself, it boils down to two things, really. When you trust something, you feel safe. If you trust a friend, you feel safe in their company. And the second thing, there is a sense of the predictable is going to happen. Somehow, there will be no surprises. There's a level of predictability that goes on with trust. That's why if somebody behaves out of character, look what they did, and I trusted them, because something unpredictable happens. But our response is about trust, because we don't feel safe there. For all of us who have developed an ego and might have gotten rid of it, might be working on getting rid of it, but for all of us who've come in and developed an ego, and I'm saying it like this because some people actually, the ego never gets solid, the lucky buggers, but it happens. We've all had our first experience of betrayal. And this is a key moment when the sense of separation comes in. For some, it's with babies. It's you're not being nurtured enough. You're crying and it's like, there's nobody there. It can happen like this for a lot of us. And sometimes you kind of might get an easy ride. And lo and behold, a friend screws you up. Your lover sleeps with somebody else and that wasn't the deal. The betrayal is inevitable. The unpredictable is inevitable because you've no control. You really have no control. And if you think life is going to be predictable, it's not. But if you are looking at life expecting it to be safe and predictable, if that's your lens of perception, you will get hurt. You will. There is another lens of perception that's available to you, which we're going to explore, which is, you know what? My lover slept with somebody else. And it's okay. Is there something wrong with me? And this happens too. So we're going to talk about the difference of what are the lenses of perception and where do you operate from? The reaction that we have on the first betrayal is key to developing our personality. And the personality needs to be developed. You need a personality. Knowing that it's not you, well, that's awakening. It's like, yeah, my personality is there. You can be refining your personality forever. But maybe it's all right just as it is. Maybe it's all right. Because it will never quite be good enough. It will never quite make the grade. Because our standards, our mind is such that the goal. That's the seeker energy. And it will even work on your own personality. I need to change that, or I'm insecure about that. And constantly morphing yourself, constantly. Can you be okay with how your personality is? Just how it is right now? There will be a natural refinement of your personality because something very deep within us moves towards that which is good, that which is better, that which takes care. Something very deep does that. So let the refinement of your personality not come from judgment, but come from this innate movement which goes towards goodness, moves towards taking care of the planet, it moves towards kindness naturally. Listen to that. If a motivation from there comes around moving, changing, altering your personality, fine. But otherwise, let it be as it is. When a huge betrayal happens, we react in one of two ways. We either decide that that is going to inform us about how we live our life. I'll never trust again. Or I'm repeatedly going after people who treat me badly because that person treated me badly and I only know how to be with somebody I can't trust. This kind of thing happens, huh? So when we take on board an experience of being betrayed, we can work it out and gain some understanding, or if it hits a level that is trauma, we know from neuroscience that the neurology that comes from that experience is 20 times stronger than other neurology in your brain. 20 times stronger. The story of trauma. So if you're working with dissolving, that's a belief that, you know, that I can't trust John. That's just a belief. I'm going to drop my belief. And you can't drop it. You just, it won't frigging go. You let go, you cut the ties, you write a letter, you burn the letter, you do all the tricks in the world. The darn thing won't go. You can be sure that it's in the trauma section. Something about that scenario reminds you of a trauma. You're going to have to heal that. That trauma will be part of the ego. Because when your brain grows something, creates a neurological pathway that is that solid, that's what the ego is. It's a series of neurological networks which make you believe what you're perceiving. Is this making sense? So when you are after a deep trauma, or when you are in the process of waking up, either one, it's interesting that it's either one, you feel like you're going to die. Because part of your body has to die. A part of your brain actually has to break. There is a death. So the very mechanism that creates your identity, this network in your brain, has to break. It's going to die. Yes, it is a death. It feels like death, and all the fear of death is going to come up. You see, it's not just the thought of me dies. It's like, yeah, but you're just a thought. It's like, yeah, that's fine. That's a spiritual concept, really. It is going to viscerally feel like a death. It has to. Be okay with it. If you understand what it is, you know, you're halfway there. It's like, okay, it's just the part of my brain actually has to dissolve a neurological pathway, and I will be left with no reference point. I will be left not knowing who I am, what I'm about, where I'm to go, what's to direct my life. Get used to it. The ego will think that that is absolute chaos and being a leaf in the wind and being directionless, but the real you knows it's freedom. Which do you want to believe? The part that looks for safety because it knows about being betrayed? Or the part of you that knows that there's a divine order in all of this? There are two options here. The whole way through, when we look at trust, there are two options. Do you come through the filter lens of pain? Or can you heal it? Or can you step back and operate from a different part of your brain? So if we look at the right and the left side of the brain, the left side looks in parts. If a betrayal happens, it will say, John betrayed me, and he slept with Susan, and she's a na-na-na, okay? We'll have parts, and the story will have characters, we'll have emotions, and why, and when did it start? And the plot thickens. It will be a huge story, because that's what your left brain does. It will only look in parts. It will break everything up and segmentize it. This actually is the belief in separation. Its capacity is to see in parts only. And it is constantly looking for safety, constantly looking for safety. Your right brain is more chilled. It recognizes that there is an interconnectivity in everything. So it sees what's the same instead of seeing what's different. So if you automatically see what's the same in all of us, and there's some crazy statistic. Does somebody know it? It's 98% or 97% or something of us is exactly the same. Exactly the same. But we are so adamant in defining what's separate, what makes me different to you. We're constantly watching with the left brain. Separate, separate, separate. It's a darn bad habit. It's a bad habit. And nothing is going to break it for you except yourself. Do you want to see the whole world in separation and how you have to defend yourself? Because it's always doing that. Your left brain is constantly looking for safety, so it's defending yourself. It's always on guard. It's suspicious. It's wary. It's dismissive. It's judgmental. If you come from the other side of your brain, it's calm. You get there with a meditation. Here's an interesting way of getting there that has nothing at all to do with meditation. I can't show you a slide of this, but here we go. So imagine there's a body, and that I've drawn a line down the body, down the center, down this line, not a midline, but this line. There's a name for it, but I can't remember it now. Going down here, right? I'm sliced this way. Put your awareness behind that line right now. Put your attention right behind that line. Just hang out there for a minute. Your right brain is being activated. It's kind of sweet, huh? It's there all the time. So start activating your right brain, your right hemisphere. Don't just do it on the cushion. Start activating it. Start seeing it's like, wow, I'm so caught in judgment. Here I am imagining that, no, or they won't sit with me at luncheon. Whatever story you have running, pull back, pull back, pull back. It's like, huh, hold on. It'll I just drop my attention back there. Now how does it look? You'll have no story because you can't see in parts. Your mind is not going to have that dialogue. What will be still there is your capacity to function. You'll still see the parts of there's a cup and there's a jar of coffee and I can pour myself a cup of coffee. Functioning will be there. But the whole dialogue around keeping you safe, being on guard, what protects you, will die away. Because that's based on separation and me having to protect myself from what is separate from me. It's bullshit. There's nothing separate from you at all. It's completely a creation of your left brain. Completely. But it gives this amazing reality feel to it. Somehow, it just is trusted. So, it's so clever, it's such a setup, that we actually trust the garbage that has been created from an experience of lack of trust. So now we're two steps in. You see? No wonder it's darn hard to drop your ego. No wonder it's hard to stop your stories. It's rigged up to get deeper and deeper into its own maya, its own illusion. I mean, grace might pop you out, but at the end of the day, you're going to have to do the work. You know how in our culture we're on devices a lot, no matter where you go, especially public transport or even people out to dinner, you know, half the people would be like checking their phone at some, and maybe I do it myself, but it's easier to see it when it's others. It's like, God, we really do that. And what it's doing is it's focusing on the parts. It's left brain, it's the part of you that engages in story, immediate vision in front of you. But if you look at like 100 years ago and all of our evolution into that, we had a perception that we could tell exactly what was behind us. We don't do it, partly because we're focusing so intently on what's in front, we don't engage with what's behind. Can you be aware of the space behind your back right now? The space behind your back. Start tuning into that. All our ancestors did it, and for the last 10 or 15 years, we've forgotten it. We've forgotten it. You know, birds still do it, and I hope they always will. We can learn so much from nature. A bird uses... is it the right eye has the left hemisphere? I'm pretty sure it is. So the left hemisphere, the particular, the focused thing, the part that's on your device, a bird is looking at a seed way down there. Left hemisphere activated. Right hemisphere is looking at the broader picture. Am I safe here? Is there another bird of prey after me? So one eye is checking the circumference, and the other eye is, I'm going for that seed down there. And both work simultaneously. We've lost it, or we are losing it. And that's kind of serious, really. It's kind of serious that we've forgotten to get the bigger picture. Have you ever noticed if you're on the phone and something happens, it's like, oh, and you have to do a double take to tune into somebody else looking for your attention, you know? And that's why, is that your left brain is working so intently that to look at your periphery, it takes a... You kind of get a jolt and you have to reorganize yourself. Your right brain is your access to pure consciousness. That is where you touch into what is beyond all of what I'm talking about. Where you touch into divine essence, where you touch into truth. Your right brain is the doorway to pure consciousness. If you're not using it, you are not going to be able to live from that place. It will get rusty. So what you do with your experiences is really important. If you create stories out of experiences, you are running new, fresh neurology in your left brain. You are creating a sense of identity, stronger, stronger, and stronger. Can you have no story? Is it all right to have no story? To have really nothing happening? There actually is nothing happening. Your beautiful mind is the only thing that makes things happen, because actually nothing at all is happening. But your mind creates difference and separation. So, the breeze and the trees, therefore, you know, it's lovely, there's a breeze, I wish to blow in here, and off we go into storyland, because we're looking at particulars. You see how it works? So what do you do with experiences that happen to you? What do you do? Do you love to have a story because it's gossip, because it's chat, because you've got something to tell somebody? Because we live in a society that loves story, loves gossip, loves it. We just want to talk about the next one. And when we're finished here at 5 o'clock, you guys are going to talk about Jack. What did you think? I was bored. She talks too fast. She that too. It's all story. Just watch it. At 5 o'clock, what story will you create about this now? Watch yourself using your left brain to build a universe that is trying to show you with all the love that it in its heart. It is not real. But it's like, actually, I'm going to make it real because I'm going to run another story which will have a reality feel to it, because that's what your left brain does very well. I'm sorry, I'm talking too fast altogether. I completely forgot about the translation. Okay, well done. You're lost too. Where did you lose me? I slowed down. Thank you. Just do that if I fly again. It's an Irish thing. We have, you know. Pardon? Yes, I'm enthusiastic. Yes, indeed. That too. That's a nice way to put it. Thank you. So it's rather a radical shift if you're going to have no story. Try it. It's worth it. I remember the first time that I really noticed that story making was gone. I was in India at the time, and a friend was over for a month or two. And we were taking a taxi to, I don't know, Pondicherry or someplace. And, you know, eventually the taxi came and we had our day and we came back. We were out to dinner with another friend that night. And she said, "Oh, what happened? What did you do today?" And my friend said, "Well, the taxi was to come at 8 o'clock. It didn't come at all. At 8:30, I called another one because Jack was just sitting down having chai." And her experience of the day was entirely different to mine. I genuinely did not notice that the taxi was late. Only that she said it, there was just, the taxi was late, really, was it? You know, I was like, wow, what's going on here? It just wasn't making story. Events weren't registering. Go there. And in the beginning, you've got to, like, your brain is making stories, but you're not going to give it the further validation of giving it words, of manifesting it as another, giving it new life. So in the beginning, your brain will make the story, but you've got to stop. Stop supporting it. And then your brain stops making the story, because actually, nothing is happening. Your left brain is the only thing that makes anything happen. So your left brain has two capacities. It has much more, but for our purposes, it's the functioning part, because without it, you probably couldn't drive a car. You need to be able to see there's a stop sign and respond accordingly. So it needs to be able to recognize parts and differences. But that functioning capacity is very different to the story-making mechanism. Everything in life promotes story. Everything. So you are opting out from the tribe if you stop doing this. You're opting out. You'll become a social bore. And it will destroy your self-image, which is beautiful. Or challenge it, at least. What you do with experiences, be careful. Be careful what you choose, huh? So when something does happen, we've got, you know, your brain can make a story, but don't give it the life force of becoming something that happened to you. If you see it, if you are seeing from your right brain, from behind the personal eye, unity consciousness is readily available to you. The non-dual is readily available to you. Because everything is interconnected. As you know, everything is interconnected. So seeing that everything is interconnected all the time, but having your brain serve you to drive the car, to choose what you want for dinner. Let your left brain serve you and put it down again. And let the perception, the truer perception, that everything is interconnected be your dominant viewing point. It's funny because every discussion, every argument comes from the left brain because it's about parts, no? And negotiating something. It can be very sticky because you can have an argument that you're invested in, or there can be an argument that's absolutely your functioning mind. Just keep an eye on that. It's like, does it mean that I can't discuss something or negotiate? It doesn't. It doesn't at all. The thing is, we started with, like, the unpredictable happens. No, that when the unpredictable happens, our trust is shaken. But the unpredictable things happen all of the time. All of the time. But our perception is so skewed that we want to keep seeing what's the same. Because we like what's the same, we like what's familiar, we like routine. So unpredictable things are actually blocked out from our perception, totally blocked out from our perception. So what's really happening is quite different to what you're perceiving is happening. It's quite different. I wish I could kind of just let you taste that more, but when I was thinking about how can I offer that, the one thing is, if you can live with what cannot be known, then your right brain can meet the world and not your left brain, because your left brain is all about the parts and about knowing things in order to feel safe, in order to be able to trust. But your right brain, living from that non-dual space, coming back from where everything is interconnected, that knows life is completely unpredictable. Anything can happen at any time. There's no control and there's no need to have control, because control is an issue for your personal left brain aspect. So from that right brain, living with the unknown is totally normal, totally normal. Can you live with the unknown, really the unknown? Really? It's like, yeah, sure, fine, I'm fine, I can trust, it can just flow anyway, but look at the sticky parts. Don't look at the parts that you've already managed. Look at the other parts. Where do your fears lie? Where do your fears lie? What are you scared of? What are you scared of? If you still have fear in your life, then you are looking from self-referencing. You're looking from left brain, you're looking from the dualistic perspective. Depends what model we can put on it. They're all the same terms, no, all different terms for the same viewing point. There was a quote that Mark Twain, I came across a quote recently. It ain't what you don't know that gets you into trouble. It's what you know for sure that just ain't so. The self-referencing will know things for sure. It likes predictability. It will be very definite about everything, have strong opinions about things. And they can be there, but you can know it's just your personality. Separate your investment from it. Totally separate your investment from it. If you're defending yourself, you'll probably know that you're invested in it. That somehow there's fear somewhere beneath this. Because the opposing point of view is a threat. If you feel threatened, if there's fear in your life, you're operating from separation. You're not seeing as a whole. And that's an exhausting way of living. It's exhausting because you're just constantly on guard. It's tough on your nervous system. It's tough on everything. So what your mind thinks it knows, let your mind have it. But it actually isn't worth crap. It's not worth anything, because that kind of knowledge is just a subjective perception in order to feel safe, in order to just have the predictable setup. That's all it's doing. It's trying to make things predictable and safe so it can navigate. That's its job. That's its job. Get a handle on it. Recognize what it's doing and say, I know what it's doing, but I'm not buying it. I know what it's doing. It's doing its best to protect me, but really, can you live in the unknown instead? I'm okay with the unknown. Is that a true statement? If it is, there will be no fear at all in your life anywhere. No fear. Go there. The next slide says, stop meeting the world with your conditioned beliefs, assumptions, and thoughts. Because everything that the self-referencing, the mechanism within you that creates an identity, every part of that has come together from life beating you around the place. That's all. And if you have those events up on a pedestal, if you have them on an altar, they're going to be very hard to let go of. What you see from your perceptions, your assumptions, your beliefs is not the truth at all. It's not. It's just your left brain's version of the world. in order to keep the sense of you going. That's all it's doing. That's all it's doing. Yeah, that's a good trick. Your mind will never know the unknowable. It will never know the unknowable. It can't, because it's unknowable, huh? The self-referencing is always looking for particulars. It sees in parts, always doing the separation gig, always. But what's unknowable is everywhere. There's loads of what's unknowable, because that's the backdrop. That's unknowable. Whereas your mind is just creating little frames to feel safe. Get used to living with the unknowable. Let the backdrop be where you're coming from. And an interesting way to do that is to tell your mind, you can never know. You're never going to know. You're never actually going to know. Get used to living with what's not known. And it's really just, it's just a switch. That one is easy enough to manage. It's like, I just got to accept the fact that I know nothing. That I can be in the place of not knowing. There's more, but it puts a parameter around the self-referencing, around the me, myself, I. It puts a parameter around that, contains it a little bit. So that you can say, okay, I know part of me is doing that, but I'm not buying it. So that kind of distance from the ego is very useful. So that you, I see your tricks, and I'm not bowing down to you. I'm not going to follow along and defend you. And that break is huge. That's what glimpses are made of. So beneath, you know, okay, we've got separation, that lens, and then we've got the non-dual lens, the oneness, the part of you that sees the whole. So beneath both of these, we drop in, and there's that divine essence. And it's interesting because there is a knowingness there. Beneath what your mind thinks it knows, beneath the it's okay not to know, and the more I am in the not knowing, the more that the wider view is available to me. Beneath both of that, those, there is a knowingness that you always had, that you had certainly as a kid. You just knew, but you don't know what you know, but you knew. And even now, taste that, that knowingness. If you're self-referencing, mechanism is allowed to access that idea. If you bring it up as an idea, it's going to just pull it apart. And your doubt is going to come, and self-criticism is going to come, and all of these things come from a lack of self-confidence. But if you have confidence in your divine essence, the core of your being, that which is outside of it, the knowingness, that sense of knowing, but you don't know what you know, trust that. That's the only thing to trust, your own inner capacity. And I'm not talking about an inner capacity that has hard-earned wisdom from the world. Don't bring your mind with you. That inner capacity doesn't use the filters of hard-earned experiences. It doesn't. I work a fair bit with spiritual teachers or those who have awakened, or, you know, they know that this isn't real. There's a lot of jargon around the word awakening, but they know that this isn't real and it's unbroken. A thought hasn't been believed for a few years. That's probably a better set of criteria for it. And what we work on is the stages between awakening and liberation. There's quite a difference between the two. That's the language I use for it. With that route, that pathway from seeing the truth to liberation, we have one primary thing to deal with, which is, are you motivated by concepts? Because it's not you believing the mind anymore, because you know there's no you. Are you motivated by concepts, or does every movement come from that which is prior to concepts? This is what we work on. So it means waiting until a movement comes from someplace else. Waiting. what most of us do is that impetus is there, but we are so caught up in the story we've created that we follow the story in order to keep us safe, in order to protect us, in order to gain something more for us. And we don't listen to that inner movement. It will have no gold for us personally at all. Nothing. There will be nothing to be gained. So it's not very sexy. That inner movement takes anywhere between 6 to 15 seconds for your brain to hear it. As yet, in our evolution, we still have something that overrides it. The primitive part of our brain, and I can't remember the name of it, but it's somewhere. The primitive part of our brain, is the neocortex, is that what it's called? Limbic system, yes. Yes, I think that's it, exactly. The one that animals have. Animals that don't know that they're thinking. You know, the ones, that natural basic instinct? That part of our brain. Where we're at currently is that part of our brain kicks in and overrides pure consciousness. We're still not evolved enough. And of course, we can use a spiritual concept to say, but it's all consciousness. Consciousness is doing all of it. It's all, and it's like, okay, you're not going to get very far with that. Don't use spiritual concepts for this. It's quite detailed. It's quite particular how this thing works. And the subtleties become more refined as we go on. So that movement from inside, if it's not taken over by basic instinct to just jump out of the way of danger, for example, if basic instinct is allowed to be there, there will be a delay factor. It will make you slow down. You won't be reactionary. It'll take you a while to hear it, to feel it. And the only way that your body, mind can cope with it, that I've seen, is to be in service to it. There's no other way that I've seen to line up with it. And this is where service comes in. This is why we kind of practice with service, because there's something in service. Yeah, you're going to need it downriver if you're not there already. Because your body mind, that's what it's for, is to bow down to that, the core of your being, that which comes from the knowingness. And so when there's a movement and you're like, oops, I don't know what I'm doing yet, but this is happening, but I don't know yet, you can see sometimes your mind is trying to play catch up. Let it be like this 24/7. The controller isn't going to like it because you have no control at all. None. No control at all. Anyway, yes. Yes.
Can you repeat
this one? Yeah. If you play with that and you start, okay, what's the natural movement here? If my mind is out of the way, let's see what happens here. The controlling mind will fight because it is out of a job. So, and the mind wants to control because that's just what it does. And that's fine. But if it redirects the inner movement of consciousness, because your mind thinks it can do better than that which moves all. It constantly does. You know, I'm not safe in the world. Okay, therefore, let's do this. Let's be on guard. Let's be suspicious. Let's just doubt everybody. It's like, okay, so now your trauma is in there as a filter lens, and it will obscure the movement of pure consciousness. You see? So without that filter lens, you'll have no control. None at all. And in theory, you might know you've no control, but actually, when it comes right down to it, the ego kicks and screams and fights because it will, I should have done that, I should have done that, I should have done that. These stories happen, huh? So let's take that leap. What if you were not to move at all, physically, not to move from your chair, from the floor at all, unless the movement came from someplace else? Rather than, oh, what's on now? I'll go and I'll do that. I'll have a cup of coffee. And, oh, it's dinner time. Oh, like, what would it be like? It's a really interesting experiment. Have you tried it? Yes. Yes. So let it be like that all of the time, because that's freedom. Yeah, that is freedom. That there's no negotiation at all. It just all stops. All the negotiation, the controlling, it all stops. And just the wisdom from outside of what your mistrusting mind, the one that looks at the parts, what that's figuring out, and what your right brain is figuring out around, oh, it's all interconnected, and with its theories around that. Prior to both of those, that's the knowingness. That's the only thing to be trusted. But it means instead of being out there, it means being back here. It means being back and just having patience and waiting, and things slow down and it gets simpler. Have your personal identity bow down in humble service to what you are. Trust your inner capacity and follow through on it, regardless of fear that mind can present. Celebrate the uncertainty and unpredictability of life with the innocent curiosity of a child again. You do full circle. You do full circle. And that inner knowingness . That's where the sense of peace and calm and ease comes from, huh? It's there all the time. Drop your attention into it. It gets very simple. There is nothing to find. There is no need to search for anything. It's just the brain doing its thing, creating an identity. That's all. It never was you. So why would you defend it? You're here all the time, being ignored. But something lines up if you can let pure consciousness organize things. And pure consciousness needs the functioning mind. It needs your brain. It needs all of these things in order to make experiencing happen. But how perception happens from your divine essence . The knowingness of what to do because of that perception does not come from an idea. It can't come from an idea. So that's why action stops coming from concepts. That's what happens after awakening and to liberation. No concept can direct your action. Because the movement of pure perception comes from the wisdom of a whole unit moving, as in all the galaxies together. It's all moving together, not because, not why, there's no reasoning, none at all. It's just a movement. It has, doesn't have story. It's not figuring out what to do, where to go. It's not. Could I talk a little bit about my own story of how I came out of mind into the knowingness? Years of trying everything. And I knew at the time that whatever I was doing, whomever I was following, whether it was hanging out in the jungle and taking plant medicine or following a guru or whatever I was doing, I knew that I'm going to go beyond this. I'm going to be on, going to go beyond this. And invariably, every time, it would be like, I've got to chew this up, take as much of it as I can, and it's going to spit me out. And that's the way it worked with me. So it was against the whole Indian tradition of, you know, you stick with one teacher, you stick with one teacher. It's like, that didn't work. Didn't work. Absolutely didn't work. I needed lots of different inputs. And I followed my gut, no matter how loopy crazy it was. No matter what friends said, like, you've lost it now. This makes no sense at all. You know, I thought you had courage, but now you're just being stupid. And I still went ahead. So doing that meant that I stopped obeying logic. I dropped common sense. I pushed against every self-image, that projection that I was trying to maintain with friends and peers and family. So the doing of it mightn't have the magic of following a particular path for like 6 months. Sometimes it wasn't actually what that practice offered, but it was the fact that I surrendered to it. And that no matter how crazy it was, I dived in to taste it fully. So very often I was pushing through the limitations in my own thinking. It didn't really matter what I was doing, really. And I started to know a pattern such as, like, I would never do that. If you make a list of what I will never do, start doing them. That's really potent. I'd never do that. Do it. If it's getting a tattoo to having sex with the sex that you usually don't have sex with, like whatever it is, just do something you would never do. That's fantastic for pushing away the limits, the right and wrong. My God, do you dig up stuff there? Whoa. Live on the edge, no? Live dangerously. Push, 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 push. Push the boundaries. Put yourself into crazy scenarios. Because the intensity of that, it's in one way it kind of speeds up the experiencing that you need to have. Because consciousness kind of, in one way, it kind of ticks off experiences. So it accelerates that. So you get loads of experiences, but it blows away all your ideas of, I'm like this, I'm not like that. I like this, I don't like that. Let them get blown out of the water. You see, we've always been, you know, playing with two sides of the coin. And those of us, like, we've been the bully and the bullied. You know, you might find in your own life, my God, I'm doing the very thing I actually said I would never do. It's great when that starts happening. Because it breaks down the one who is tied to one type of behavior. It breaks down your restriction to the idea of what you thought was right and good and true. Like, I broke into people's houses. I stole women's wallets. Like, I pushed it just because there was a law about it and a rule, and it'd be a thing I would never do. I'd never do it. I'd be like, all right. And if I go get caught and go to prison, I'm going to go. I never got caught. I broke rules, a lot of rules. But I always used them for my spiritual practice. It was always about, like, what do I, yeah, the Catholic Irish girl, you know, here we go. Like, what can I, what belief, what limitation can I break now? Very effective. Very effective. Stop being good. Stop being good. And be bad for the right reasons.